If you're a guest with us today, we're just really glad that you're here. If you would look in your bulletin, you would find a set of notes. If you will take those notes out, we're in our second part of a series that I just started entitled Relationship Matters. And I want to talk about for a few moments today, great relationships get the little things right. The biblical goal of relationships, the Bible says, is to love your neighbor by doing good to them and to help them align their relationship to God's purposes for each other. In marriage, it's to learn to take action on the behalf of your spouse that will help them become more like Jesus. It's the same goal, regardless if you're single, married, whatever relationship you're in. Obviously, that can't be done without a personal relationship with Jesus and His Holy Spirit, who comes to empower us to be the person we were created to be. God wants us all to have good relationships and good friendships and marriages. It's a fantasy to think that you can have anything perfect. That's simply our pride usurping itself. I'd like to encourage you in your friendships. If you're frustrated lately with your friend because your friend isn't as good or as perfect as you think they should be, they never will, because we're all broken. Would you agree?
Yes.
If I want to encourage any spouse here, if you're frustrated with your spouse because you don't think they're perfect enough, you just need to understand that's an impossibility. They're sinful. They're flawed. However, we can be good spouses. We can be good parents. We can be good friends. The goal is not perfection, but it's progress. This morning, I want to give you 6 action steps that every one of us in this room can take, and those who will be listening to a CD or they're following us on our website, steps you can take to have a good relationship, a good friendship, a good marriage, by taking care of these 6 little things. Now, this phrase, 6 little things, reminds me of 2 stories I heard recently. One was about a man who said to his wife, "When I get mad at you, you never fight back. How do you handle your anger so amazingly well?" His wife responds, "I just clean the toilet." "Well, how does that help?" he asks. "I use your toothbrush," she responded. There was a couple who was debating the purchase of a couple cars they needed to get. He wanted a new truck. She wanted a fast little sports car that could zip around traffic and through town. He probably would have settled on any beat-up truck, but everything she seemed to like was out of their price range. She said, "Look, I just want you to get me something that can go from 0 to 220 in 4 seconds or less. My birthday's coming up. Just surprise me." So for her birthday, he bought her a brand new bathroom scale. You can tell I'm not a good joke teller. I shouldn't be laughing, but I practiced this and practiced this, and I'm sorry. That was pretty funny. Simone Signoret has written this: "Chains do not hold a marriage together." If you got me a scale, I would be so happy. Listen, I have a whole closet full of scales, so it's not offensive to me, but my wife wouldn't appreciate that gift at all. "Chains do not hold a marriage together. It is threads, hundreds of tiny threads, which sew people together through the years." So I want to look at 6 activities of sewing these tiny threads that can cause friendships and relationships and a marriage the intimacy and the connection that they long for. The threads that cause relationships and friendships to grow strong need to intentionally be connected. In her book, For Better, How the Surprising Science of Happy Couples Can Help Your Marriage, Tara Parker Pope writes this. What marital science teaches us is that improving a marriage or a friendship doesn't require sweeping changes. Couples or individuals in friendships get the little things right. The broad trends of marriage and divorce give us reason to be hopeful. Divorce is getting less common. Couples are waiting longer to get married. And once a man and a woman do finally decide to marry, the marriage and divorce statistics clearly show that the odds of staying married are in their favor. So let's look at six actions you can take to make your friendship, the relationships that you want to see grow, and if you're married, your marriage relationship. Look at number one, celebrate the good. Proverbs 13:2 says this, good people enjoy the positive results of their words, but those who are treacherous crave violence. Proverbs 13:2 in the Message says this, the good acquire a taste for helpful conversations. Bullies push through and shove their way through life. In the epic poem Paradise Lost, John Milton writes this, good, the more communicated and abundant grows. The Bible says good people enjoy the positive results of their words because they focus on having helpful, beneficial, mutually edifying and uplifting conversations with their family, with their friends, with their coworkers, and with their family. Pope writes that the marital research shows that couples who regularly celebrate the good times have higher levels of commitment, intimacy, trust, friendship, and satisfaction. Unfortunately, the marriage that I grew up in, it was quite negative. The talk at times could be very, very harmful. So I have to, I confess to you, I can have a tendency, I have to be very careful that I just don't drift off into negativity. And I think you'll agree with me, we all drift. You would just drift, you automatically do. I remember when I was much younger, about 30, 40 years ago, a pastor friend of mine who's a pilot, he heard me talking and I was just distraught, saying, I've got to make some monumental changes in my life. You know, that's, if you think I'm that way now, I was much more then. You know, the sky was burning, it was falling, and I had to make some monumental changes. And he looked at me, he said, let me tell you a story. He says, I'm a pilot. And he says, from the moment the plane gets off the tarmac and until it lands, it's constantly off target. Because you just drift. And he looked at me and he said, a good pilot doesn't sit there and go, oh, I'm not on the right track. And then go like this. The whole plane goes, and then, oh, I'm off. And he says, Scott, that's what your life is like. You're just always careening all over the place. He said, son, you just need to make small adjustments. So if you're here today and you're frustrated with your life and you're thinking, you know, I just got to do everything at mock speed or harder or this or that, just relax. Just one little small incremental adjustment can do a lot of good things. A wise couple, a small friend, a discerning employer, a leader will capitalize on the positive events in their lives. In simple terms, this truth means that you need to make a big deal out of the good moments in your relationships and in your marriage. Regardless of how negative you might feel right now about your spouse or your children or yourself or your life, there are good things happening in your life. They might seem very small to you, but the Bible says that a good person acquires the taste for helpful, uplifting, positive conversation. Things to look for when you celebrate. Did your friend's meeting go well? Did your spouse's meeting go well? Have they achieved any of the goals that they set for 2018? Have you asked your spouse or friend or somebody in your small group lately, and we do this in our small group, hey, what breakthrough have you had this year, since 2018 is the year of breakthrough? Where have you had a spiritual victory, a prayer answered, success in reading the Bible consistently, maybe for 2 days or 3 days or whatever the truth is for you? I have more of you coming up to me saying, you know, this is the first time I've ever done an organized reading like this. I can't believe the changes that are happening when I spend time in God's Word every day. Yes. Yes. That's how transformation takes place. That's how you change in your mind how you see things, is by exposing yourself to God's Word. Has that person been consistently attending Sunday services? Have they been, for the first time for them, attending small group? We had someone in our small group who has missed 3, 4, and just said, you know, when I miss, it just throws everything off. I get off base. And I said, well, don't beat yourself up. We love you. Just get back in the groove. Have they had an emotional victory? Are they telling the truth more often than they used to? Are they setting boundaries for themselves and learning to say no and yes when it's appropriate? Are they learning to control their life, their thought life? Are they becoming more positive? Or is their thought life causing them to be depressed and disappointed and despair? What relational victories have they had? One of the persons in our church just recently said they'd been out of source with a friend, and they're working on reconciling their relationship, and their life is just getting better. As we were changing to come back in here, David said, in the last 6 years, my life has just gotten better, and since coming to CV, things are just getting better. Those are moments to celebrate. What physical victories have they had? Are they changing their diet? And because of it, maybe they've lost a few pounds. A friend came up to me last week and said, I've lost 7 pounds. I just hugged him and said, congratulations. That's a big deal. You get the point. Look for the smallest victories, growth points, and celebrate them. I think one of the main reasons we won't celebrate the small things is because we're waiting for those big, sweeping changes to happen before we can celebrate. And before we can praise a spouse or friend. I had parents say, I said, well, did you celebrate that with your child? Oh, if I celebrate that with them, I'm afraid they're going to get a big head and it'll just ruin everything. So I said, well, that makes sense. Just starve them for affirmation and they'll do better. No, it doesn't work. Look at point number 2. Learn what I call relationship math. Ephesians 4:29 says this. Don't use foul, abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words be an encouragement to those who hear them. Notice what the Bible says. Let everything you say be good and helpful. Why would God instruct us to watch and evaluate every word we speak? Because he knows the damage negative, harsh, angry words have. Again, marital science confirms the truth of this scripture. One of my favorite authors in the science of marriage research is Dr. Gottman. And he videotaped couples in conversation. And he would then catalog every nice or negative thing a couple did or said during their discussion. Things like laughing, touching, smiling, or paying a compliment were described as positive interactions. But he also tracked the number of not-so-nice moments. The rolling of eyes, which is a sign of contempt, sneers, criticism, defensiveness, anger, and withdrawal. As the researchers studied the data, they noticed a striking pattern emerged. In stable and good relationships, friendships, and marriages, there are at least 5 times more positive interactions than negative ones. Just think about this. When the ratio starts to dip, the friendship, the relationship, the marriage is at a higher risk of breaking down. in marriage, they're heading for divorce. Here's where it becomes really practical. Just saying, "I'm sorry," after bad behavior is not enough. For every snide comment or negative outburst in a relationship, specifically in this research, in a marriage, a person needs to ramp up the positives so the good to bad ratio doesn't fall at a risky level. Again, just so you know where I come from, our family ran in the deficit all the time. Emotionally, relationally, we were in the minus, -5, -8 on an ongoing basis. Mom and dad just kept everything in a tumultuous upheaval. The lesson here is do the marriage and do the relational math. For some of us who focus on the negative in ourselves and in our friends or spouses, when you do make a commitment to yourself that you're going to do at least 5 positive things for your spouse to make up for the criticism, to make up for the negative comments or actions, positive words, gestures go a long way to build up what's called your love account, so the inevitable negative times, when they come, you can weather the storm. The point is to become an avid fan of investing in your love bank with your spouse, your children, your friends, your employees, your employers. Celebrate the good. Learn relationship math. Look at number 3. Hold your standards high. Would you read with me Philippians chapter 4, verse 8? Let's read that together. Let's begin. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Now, why would the Bible say fix or focus, or I would translate it obsess on these thoughts and virtues? Because what you think of consistently is what you will become and what you have in your life. If you are always fearful, if you run anxious, you will have some kind of break somewhere. Because your body just can't handle that. If you're a real committed pessimist, you will just continue to have this dark cloud follow you. Because what you think is what you become and what you have. Here is the power of making these commitments. And you might just write this down. You are what you yield to. And you become what you're committed to. You are what you yield to. You become what you're committed to. Oftentimes, I can tell a lot of someone by just looking at them because your commitments mark you. Because you make hundreds of commitments, whether you know it or not, every day. And your commitments will literally shape you. They shape your brain and how it thinks. Again, relationship and marital research confirms this powerful truth. The research is very important. It is true that too many friends and spouses will demand more of a relationship that is helpful at times. But more recent research shows that good, high standards are a good thing. Dr. Balcom from the University of North Carolina found that people who have high standards, who really want to be treated well, and who want romance and passion for their marriage end up getting that kind of marriage. Men and women with low standards who don't expect good treatment, communication, or romance end up in relationships that don't offer those things. What I'm saying is very important to setting high standards for your marriage and relationships. God created us to experience oneness in our relationships and oneness in marriage. In order for oneness to happen in marriage, it requires two complete people. The Bible defines a complete person as a mature person. And I find Dr. Townsend and Cloud's material is the best I've ever read on any of this, so I've put it on the PowerPoint for you. A complete person is not a perfect person, but they're able to do the things that adult life and relationships require. What does an adult relationship require? Especially if you're single, if you're 19, 20, 22, 23, 24, 25, and you're wanting to get married someday, here are the relational skills you must have. that you can give love and receive love, that you can be independent and self-sufficient, that you can live out your values honestly, that you are responsible, that you have self-confidence, that you can deal with your problems and failures, that you live out of your talents, and that you have a life. If two people who marry, hear me, are complete, the oneness they establish will be complete. To the degree that either person is less than complete as a person, the oneness will suffer under the strain of that incompleteness. This is really profound. This is why I say, don't look for your other half. Be a whole, complete person. The incomplete partner's longing for completeness will take precedent over what he or she is able to give to the relationship. And the relationship will suffer. This is one of the best definitions of codependency I have ever heard in my life. We have a tendency to be drawn to people who have strengths we don't have, and we don't think of it this way, but we're going to just parasitically link up to them and suck the strength out of them. If you do that, you will destroy the relationship. And this is where blame shifting comes in. Well, I married you because I thought you were going to be able to help me. You're no help at all. You just keep insisting that I grow up. You keep insisting that I take responsibility. Well, that's no fun. You're the responsible one. I should be able just to skate on you. Yeah. Does this make sense? Yes. Marriage is about complementing each other, not completing. People who divorce, it's because they thought they finally found somebody that can complete them. Kathy cannot complete me. It's not in her DNA. God did not wire her to complete me. I cannot complete Kathy. We must, in Christ, be completed and then grow in these skills so that we can build what God wants our specific marriage to build. He had something in mind when he wanted Scott and Kathy to become one. Same thing with you. We're too busy trying to build our own thing instead of discovering God's purpose and plan for the relationship. And this is true for all relationships. Again, Townsend Cloud write this: marriage was not designed to complete a person. Marriage was designed for two complete people to enter into and form something different than either of them is on his or her own. It was designed not to make you a whole person, but get this, to give you a wholeness and a whole new range of experience. Isn't that beautiful? In other words, God says, I'm going to take these children, take Darren and Amanda, and I'm going to take Doug and Kyung, I'm going to take Polly, I'm going to take Katia, because I want to see them together build something that they can't build on their own. And the problem with codependency is it stops the building. You can't build what God wants you to build when you're constantly taking from your spouse instead of complimenting. So it is as we continue to grow and mature in our own personal sense of completeness that you can have appropriate standards for your relationship. And I'd like to go into that. I can't, but appropriate. Most of us have inappropriate expectations of our spouses. And this is why some of us are angry with our spouse or friends. We're bitter. And if you're honest, some of us maybe hate our spouses. And it's not your spouse's problem. It starts with you and it starts with me, understanding we're not there to complete each other, we're there to complement. Same thing true with body life in the church. No one here can complete it. I can't complete you, you can't complete me, but we can complement each other. And when we're all doing what God has shaped us to do,
We can make a difference together. Number four, stay in touch with family and friends. 1 Timothy 5, 1 and 2 says this, never speak harshly to an older man, but appeal to him respectively as you would to your own father. Some of us might say, well, that's how I talk to my dad. Well, that's not good. Hey, old man. I hate that phrase. There's one phrase I hate worse than that. I speak to the old man upstairs. That's so disrespectful. He's not an old man, and he's not upstairs. He is your father, and he created you, and he has a purpose and a plan for your life. And if you will begin to think more appropriately about him, you might see him for who he really is. He's a loving God, a merciful God, a compassionate God, a forgiving God. He's wonderful. Never speak harshly to an older man, but appeal to him respectively. Talk to younger men as you would your own brothers. Talk to older women as you would your mother. Treat younger women with all purity as you would your own sisters. As a culture, we've become way too privatized. We don't want our family, friends, and CV Church family to know if we're struggling. Throughout history, friends and neighbors and coworkers have always been an important source of social, personal, and financial support to friends and couples. But research has shown today that many people view their husband or their wife as their primary source of support. Many couples even believe that outsiders can actually interfere with the marital bond, and they distance themselves from close outside relationships. Sociologist Naomi Gerstle of the University of Massachusetts Amherst and Natalia Sarkeesian from Boston College have found that married people have fewer ties to relatives than people who aren't married. Now, I know in our church we have certain ethnic groups that have a very, very, very high commitment and value with family, so they have a lot of family around them. Some of us don't. In the last 30, 40 years, I have lived apart from family. They are less likely to visit or call their parents and other family members compared to relatives who are single. Marriage can also cut a couple's tie to the larger community. Married people are less likely to socialize with their neighbors or help out with their friends. This is amazing. Marriage historian Stephanie Kuntz writes this, today, we expect much more intimacy and support from our partners than in the past, but much less from everyone else. This puts a huge strain on the institution of marriage. We often overload marriage by asking our partner to satisfy more need than any one person possibly can meet. This is profound. This ties in famously with what I read to you from Townsend and Clown. The best way to improve your relationship, your friendship, your marriage, is to focus, loved ones, on your own maturity, to grow spiritually, emotionally, relationally, financially, vocationally, intellectually, and physically. Stop focusing on your spouse. Focus on your maturity. Include your small group. Include your friends. Include your family. Two of the greatest advocates for Kathy's and my marriage were my father and my brother-in-law. I lost a lot when having those two men die. I've had to find other men who can support and affirm my marriage, my role as a husband, and my role as a father, and my role as a pastor. Look at number five. Steward your sexuality, whether you're single or married. I'm going to read two passages of scripture here. 1 Thessalonians 4, 3 through 6. God's will is for you to be holy. The word holy there, hagios, means to be set apart for God. So stay away from all sexual sin. Then each of you will control your own body and live in holiness and honor, not just in lustful passion like non-believers who don't know God and his ways. Never harm or cheat a Christian brother or sister in this matter by violating his wife or her husband, for the Lord avenges all such sin as you have solemnly warned you before. Our culture is just sexually schizophrenic. And what this passage is saying is, whether I am single or whether I am married, God has given me my body that has sexual desires and sexual capabilities, and I am to live my life in such a way that I bring honor and glory to God, and then I bring honor to the rest of you on how I relate to you. Now, I've told this story before, but some of you are new. Oh, there was a woman who worked in the entertainment industry, and somehow she found her way here. And I could tell when she was on the campus, because guys' heads, you could hear a chiropractic snap, and you just hear boom, boom, boom. And I go, such and such is here. And she was fairly endowed, and she would always be quite revealing. So I had to make sure when she came out the door, I'd put a little bullseye on her forehead, and I'd just stare at her forehead. A couple months later, she brings one of her many bows in, and she starts talking about something. And she said, I just don't know why men always look at me. And I thought, I felt like the Holy Spirit said, now. So I said to her, look down. She went like this, and I said, what do you see? I see what you see. I don't want to see that. You are not a friend to me when you are dressed like this. This is not good. You're embarrassing yourself, and it's too tantalizing to other people. And she looked at me, and she said, well, you're the only man I feel that I can trust. And I said, well, it's because I put a bullseye on your forehead, because I'm not going to be seduced by you. I was just, this is hammer time. Tootsie the other day, he just said, you always bring the hammer. So, you know, can't touch this. Boom, 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 boom. Now, she hasn't been back since. Ah. But I think I did her a service, because nobody had ever told her the truth. Now, look at 1 Corinthians 7, 3 to 5. The husband should fulfill his wife's sexual needs, and the wife should fulfill her husband's needs. We're going to go in this in two or three teachings down the road. The wife gives authority over her body to her husband. The husband gives authority over his body to his wife. Do not deprive each other of sexual relations unless you both agree to refrain from sexual intimacy for a limited time so you can give yourselves more completely to prayer. Afterwards, you should come together so that Satan won't be able to tempt you because of your lack of control. Now, what is Paul saying? He is saying there is to be a mutuality in sexual intimacy in marriage. You can see where each spouse must be growing in their own maturity and their own sense of completeness. You can demand that your spouse fulfill your needs, but it isn't going to work unless each spouse takes their relationship with Jesus seriously. These are real fighting passages. The husband and wife are to fill each other's needs. They are to give their bodies to their spouse for pleasure. Paul argues that meeting each other's need is an important way so Satan won't tempt you because of your lack of self-control. That is the spiritual side of our sexuality. On the physiological and biological side of our sexuality, did you know that the simple act of intercourse in marriage, whether you're in the mood or not, actually harnesses your brain chemistry? It unleashes chemicals, vasopressin and oxytocin. These are powerful bonding chemicals. Experts tell the low-desired couple that you should be sexually intimate with each other even when you don't want to. After about 5 minutes of going through some of the emotions, sexual activity will actually begin to release chemical bonding, and you're likely to start enjoying the process. One woman tells of her experience where when she was done having children, she just became sexless. She had lost interest, and the couple were talking divorce. She went to a therapist, and the therapist gave her advice that she did not like. He basically said, even if you don't want to, you need to be intimate with your husband. This woman was sternly told that if she wanted to save her marriage, she would need to be having sex at least twice a week with her husband, whether she wanted it or not. She looked at him and said, I hate this advice, but I followed it anyway. She said, you know what happened? I ended up getting back into the habit. Actually, the emotions for my husband came back, and that literally, that kind of connection saved our marriage. If you're here and you're married and you need help, I encourage you to get help. If there's somebody in the church you trust, if you need to find a professional counselor, find somebody and get help. Is this making sense? Do you hear how quiet it is? Yes. I love that quiet. Hammer time. Number six. Engage on a regular date, day, or night. 1 Corinthians 7:33 and 34. A married man has to think about his earthly responsibilities, how to please his wife, but a married woman has to think about her earthly responsibilities, how to please her husband. If you are single, you need to make sure that whoever your friends are, that you are having regular time with your friends, having fun, doing the things you like to do with them, so you can have a sense of community and a sense of connectedness. Most studies of love and marriage show that the decline of romantic love over time is inevitable. Are you aware that in our culture, basically, the culture says this: love is infatuation and it's chemically driven. You can fall in love, but you will fall out of love. So don't be shocked by that. When you fall out of love, just find somebody else and get a new chemical reaction. But that's not what the Bible says love is about, because love is not, does not equal an emotion or equal a feeling. Love researchers have come up with a way for long-term married couples to rekindle their feelings of romance. It is to embark on a regular day or night. I'm not good at night. Kathy and I, since Friday's off, that's the day that we're working on having our date. I just like to call it date day. She likes to go into the night. So I try to start us early in the morning and say we had 6, 7, 8 hours. Isn't that good? And the answer is usually not that good. The advice is based in brain science. New experience activates the brain's reward system, flooding it with the brain chemical dopamine and norepinephrine. These are the same brain circuits that ignited in early romantic love, a time of exhilaration, obsessive thoughts about your new partner. The key is to do some new things. So, couples, if you've been marrying for a while and things are boring, the fire seems to be low or gone, one of the ways you can rekindle it is, guys, you be the champions for a date day or a date night. And it needs to be consistent. It needs to be regular. Kathy's love language is quality time. If I don't speak that language, if I don't do that, I can guarantee you our relationship ebbs. It just does. I wish it wasn't that way, but that's the way it is. This is part of our responsibility as marrieds, to do the things that are pleasing to our spouses in friendships, to do things where we serve and we love and we sacrifice for our friends so that we can make these thousands of little, small, threaded connections. And I want to close with this. This is why reading your Bible daily is so important. If you want to have those kind of threads of connection with your Lord and your Savior, you've got to spend time with Him. You just have to. Reading the scriptures, prayer, reflection, taking time to just be still, listen to Him, ask Him to give you direction, ask Him to give you clarity. And you'll find that as you spend more time and you begin to hear God's heartbeat and you walk with Him, you will find that your relationships will start to get better. As you take time to listen to Him, you'll find yourself wanting to listen to your friends, listen to your family, and listen to your spouse. Is this helpful?
Yes.
Let's pray. Father, we thank You that You are relentlessly relational and that You desire to have relationship with us. And You desire that we take care of these little things in our relationships. So I ask that You would help my brothers and sisters, and as we go into small groups this week, that there'll be good discussion about how to celebrate the good, how to learn relationship math. That, Lord, for some of our relationships, friendships as singles, friendships as married, our standards might be a little too low. That we stay in touch with our family and we stay in touch with our friends. And, Lord, that we steward our sexuality, whether we're single or married. And then that we engage on a regular day or night each week. That we're building up our friendships, we're building up our relationships, and we're building up our marriages. We thank You for it. In Jesus' name we pray.